Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Intuitive Eating for Life, How Mindfulness Can Deepen and Sustain Your Intuitive Eating Practice, by Jenna Hollenstein, MD, RD, CDN, narrated by Daniela Acitelli. Introduction. Welcome to the beginning of the rest of your life. That might sound dramatic, but I mean it. This is life-changing stuff. I'm glad you're here. You've probably already heard of intuitive eating. It's everywhere, and people are talking about how great it is. Perhaps you bought the intuitive eating book or workbook, felt enormous relief, tried to let go of rigid control over how you ate, experimented with some forbidden foods. After decades of dieting, it's liberating to think you can eat what you love without guilt or shame. But finding a balanced approach to eating without restricting or binging feels impossible. Without the structure of rules and diets, you may have begun to feel unmoored. Without restricting, you gained weight. You felt you were losing control, confirming you can't trust your body. Perhaps you concluded there was something different about your body and that intuitive eating won't work for you. No, you're not alone. Intuitive eating, the evidence-based model created by registered dietitians Evelyn Triboli and Elise Resch that will completely transform your relationship with food and body, is simple but not easy to do, especially on your own. Intuitive eating is not the eat when you're hungry, stop when you're full diet. It does not progress linearly through neatly organized principles. It unfolds differently for each person doing it. So while there are some common milestones, individual variations in experience can feel unexpected and insurmountable. Many people have found success with intuitive eating by working with a professional like myself, a nutrition therapist trained by its creators, someone to reflect your experience back to you, encouraging you to celebrate your progress, guiding your attention, recognizing obstacles, and supporting your work to deepen self-knowledge. Simply being in relationship with someone who holds space for you and believes in you can help you sustain intuitive eating when things inevitably become difficult. This book is not meant to replace the support of a certified intuitive eating counselor, which, if accessible, is always recommended. Unfortunately, this professional help is not equitably available. It is expensive and time-consuming. It's not easy to find a clinician who gets you, looks like you, understands what it's like to live in your body, and it is often not of long enough duration to support the lifelong unfolding of intuitive eating. Becoming an intuitive eater involves uncertainty and discomfort, two things you might not feel well-equipped to deal with. There's no manual explaining how to get comfortable with discomfort. Given the varying experiences with intuitive eating, its inherent challenges, and the need for healing through relationship, where does that leave you? This is where mindfulness comes in. Mindfulness bridges the gap. Mindfulness trains you to stay with yourself, even or especially when things get uncomfortable. Mindfulness is a way of life in which you place attention on your moment-to-moment reality. You notice and tend to bodily sensations, emotions, thoughts, and the environment with curiosity, compassion, and gentleness. You expand to tolerate the full range of your emotions and experiences, the good, the bad, and everything in between. Mindfulness helps you recognize when you are replaying something from your past, fantasizing about the future, or simply daydreaming, and to come back to the present moment again and again. In coming back, you can recognize what is actually happening in your life, not what you fear will happen, wish would happen, or think should happen. When you are authentically in your real life, you see yourself honestly. You recognize how you personally, and we as a society, have suffered at the hands of the diet culture and its inhumane expectations. You inventory its costs to your life. You assess the dissonance between your thoughts and actions in pursuit of thinness and your true values. You make connections between beliefs, thoughts, emotions, and actions, and can course correct in real time. This reorientation toward your genuine self lets you live with openness, purpose, and joy. Mindfulness also connects you with your body, mind, and heart in ways that help you navigate difficulty. It strengthens resilience and cognitive flexibility so that discomfort and uncertainty don't derail you. Instead, you can soften toward them and learn what they need to teach you. Finally, mindfulness puts you in deeper relationship with yourself and others. This enhances self-compassion and sharpens self-observation. Ultimately, you build confidence and trust in your body's self-regulation and your mind's flexibility. When you trust your body and feel confident in your basic goodness, how you relate to others is exponentially improved. It's a hard sell to recommend getting comfortable with discomfort, but suffering is a universal human experience. It is central to why you struggle with food in your body. It is also how you will ultimately heal. As you move through the book, you will notice many moments of uncertainty and discomfort. You will see how they reveal important information about your relationship with food and body, and likely your relationship with life in general, and present opportunities to transform confusion into wisdom and compassion. There are paradoxes inherent in this work. You are capable of authentic change, but the responsibility does not rest solely on you. You can make changes on an individual level, but your body, all bodies, are part of something larger. What is mindfulness and where does it come from? Mindfulness comes from ancient Buddhist teachings about the nature of reality. The first teaching, given by the Buddha once he attained enlightenment, the Four Noble Truths, is the closest you'll ever get to that elusive manual on how to get comfortable with discomfort. The Four Noble Truths, those non-negotiable qualities of life in a human body, are 1. The truth of suffering, 2. The cause of suffering, 3. The cessation of suffering, 4. The path to the cessation of suffering. The first noble truth does not mean life is terrible. It means we all experience some dis-ease in our lives. Sickness, old age, and death are examples. But so are the icky feeling of a too tight waistband and the disappointment of bad takeout. The second noble truth is suffering is caused by resistance to the first noble truth. When we fight the truth of suffering and desperately try to only experience pleasure, we end up miserable. The third noble truth is that there is a way out. While the fourth noble truth defines the path, which includes right understanding, right thought, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. Mindfulness is essential in the fourth noble truth, the path to the cessation of suffering. It is infused into every other part of the path. Its most basic meaning is to be fully in the moment. Mindfulness teaches you to recognize each moment as sacred and as yet unexperienced. Throughout this book, you will see how certain moments of your life reveal important information about your relationship with food and body, if you pay attention to them. By noticing these poignant moments, naming them, and working with them as they are, you will ultimately transform that relationship. The Four Noble Truths of Having a Body. My clients always hear me say, "Don't leave out your body." The word mindfulness is a misnomer because of its emphasis on mind. In reality, what happens in the body is even more important. When the mind recognizes and interprets what is happening in the physical and emotional body as it interacts with itself, with others, and with its environment, awareness happens. In the spirit of not leaving out the body, let's apply the Four Noble Truths to the body and how they relate to food, eating, and dieting. 1. Existing in the world in a human body is hard. 2. Trying to bypass this difficulty by dieting and controlling your body only increases your suffering. 3. There is a way out that includes working with instead of against your body. 4. The path is framed by mindfully working through the 10 principles of intuitive eating. Having a body is hard. It can get sick or injured. It hurts sometimes and ages day by day. Parts of your body may not work like they used to, and your body may not always perform or appear as you wish. This can be disappointing and upsetting. There is nothing you can do to change this. Without perspective, these truths can be difficult to accept. The diet culture, the system of industries rooted in healthism and Eurocentric beauty ideals, preys on your difficulty accepting this truth. It presents weight loss as a means to relieve or avoid suffering, creating a perfect storm in which you feel obligated to work on your body, always trying to improve it, never letting it be enough. Diet culture creates inhumane standards to achieve worthiness few can attain. It invents problems and then sells you the solutions. It distracts you from what you probably value a lot more than beauty and thinness: happiness, connection, being of benefit. You can break this cycle by reimagining your relationship with food and your body. This involves learning to work with your body, listening to it, asking it what it wants and needs, acknowledging its basic goodness, and finally, learning to work with discomfort and uncertainty. The path to the cessation of suffering with our bodies is paved by the 10 principles of intuitive eating. 1. Reject the diet mentality. 2. Honor your hunger. 3. Make peace with food. 4. Challenge the food police. 5. Discover the satisfaction factor. 6. Feel your fullness. 7. Cope with your feelings with kindness. 8. Respect your body. 9. Movement. Feel the difference. 10. Honor your health. Gentle nutrition. As of the 4th edition of Intuitive Eating, Discover the Satisfaction Factor was placed before Feel Your Fullness. Principle 7 was edited to say cope with your feelings with kindness instead of without food, and the word exercise in Principle 9 is now movement. I share this because it emphasizes how we all continue to evolve in our understanding of intuitive eating, even its creators. Where intuitive eating and mindfulness intersect. Intuitive eating and mindfulness are innately compatible and complementary. Both seek to work with reality. In one sense, reality is that certain things are out of your control, while others are at least somewhat within your control. The size and shape of your body are largely determined by factors out of your control, such as genetics. How you have come to perceive your body is determined by larger systems that center thinness, whiteness, youth, and beauty. Knowing this, how you think and feel about your body is subject to your influence. You can change how you think and feel to focus less on how to change your body and more on how to care for it. Reality also means the constantly changing needs of your human body. How your body protects you from starvation, i.e., dieting, and how battling with your body only intensifies suffering. By working with reality, you stand squarely in the middle of your real life, not some imagined future where everything is perfect. Mindfulness helps you practice the first principle of intuitive eating by recognizing that diets don't work. Your own lived experience reveals how you have repeated the same pattern, trying one diet after the next, or committing to restrictive lifestyle changes you don't realize are diets. Once you accept this truth, there is no going back. Intuitive eating and mindfulness are embodied practices deeply connected with interoception. The ability to sense inward, accurately interpret what is presently happening in your body, and respond with precision and kindness. Honing interoception through mindfulness supports you to honor hunger, discover satisfaction, respect fullness, develop a sustainable movement practice, and ultimately experiment with nutrition. This work is enlivened by respect for your innate intelligence. You are the only true expert of you. You possess wisdom sharpened by working with your mind and listening to your body and heart. Intuitive eating and mindfulness teach you the importance of tolerating discomfort, making peace with food, continuing to challenge the food police, and more precisely sensing and responding to emotions require you to feel, allow, and stay with your experience, even as it becomes uncomfortable. This helps you recognize automatic reactions to discomfort. By slowing things down, you can respond skillfully instead of reacting automatically, gradually breaking dysfunctional cycles that cause you harm. Mindfulness helps you recognize how intuitive eating affects your life in small and large ways. You learn that whatever you do, you are just trying to feel okay. Sometimes this is through dysfunctional thoughts or behaviors. But mindfulness and intuitive eating support you to feel okay by enacting true self-care. Learning to respect your body unconditionally. Cultivating self-compassion and bravely turning toward your real life empowers you to work with each experience authentically. Finally, both intuitive eating and mindfulness are paths, not destinations or endpoints. You can't mess them up. Both processes unfold at an appropriate pace for you. And, spoiler alert, this unfolding continues for the rest of your life. How to use this book. This book is a complement to the Intuitive Eating book and the Intuitive Eating Workbook. It is a resource to return to as your intuitive eating practice evolves over your life. During physical, emotional, social, and spiritual changes, you can return to this book to stay connected with and deepen your intuitive eating practice. The book is structured within the Four Foundations of Mindfulness, a Buddhist framework that increases awareness and removes obstacles to working with life on life's terms. The four foundations are mindfulness of body, mindfulness of feelings, mindfulness of mind, or thoughts, and mindfulness of dhammas, or phenomena. Each foundation of mindfulness is related to the others, as are the 10 principles of intuitive eating. That interconnectedness does cause some overlap. When you begin, consider going all the way through the whole book and then returning to a specific section to dig in. This is a resource for any time you encounter obstacles on your intuitive eating path. Consider it my way of being there with you, holding space for you, cheering you on, reminding you that you were born an intuitive eater, and reassuring you that the painful points teach you exactly what you need to learn. So please stay. Mindful moments are sprinkled throughout the book. Get a journal, open a note in your phone, or start a document in which you record thoughts, feelings, reactions, and noticings. These exercises will help you make the practice truly yours, to deepen awareness, conduct experiments, observe yourself non-judgmentally, and continually speak to yourself with compassion. I encourage you to celebrate progress, early and often. My definition of progress may be different from yours. It's progress when you notice yourself in the moment, having different experiences than you did before, responding in intentional ways and connecting the dots between thoughts, feelings, and behaviors. If you don't celebrate progress with a little p and hold out for progress with a big P, you'll miss all the ways in which you are already eating intuitively. There are also materials available for download, including supportive resources and additional meditation instructions at the website for this book. newharbinger.com/49401. Before we begin, I have written this book with the aspiration of helping you regain trust and confidence in your body, mind, and heart, because I believe that will ultimately make the world a better place. I have done so from a limited position, however, so there are likely aspects of your experience that are not adequately or sensitively addressed here. For that, I apologize in advance. I benefit from substantial and unearned privilege. I am a white, thin, able-bodied, educated, middle-class woman. I have one child, a babysitter, and childcare support from my parents, without whom none of this would be possible. My partner works full-time, which has allowed me to write a book. I live with depression and anxiety, common mental illnesses I feel compelled to destigmatize, and chronic pain. I have had the privilege of learning to meditate and to study the Dharma. This has changed everything for me. While this book speaks to you as an individual, which suggests that accepting your body is a personal responsibility, the truth is that there are unjust and inhumane social systems that make us feel not at home in our bodies. How to change those systems is beyond the scope of this book, but has been addressed well by many wonderful authors, social justice warriors, and activists. Please explore some of these other titles in the resources offered online at newharbinger.com/49401. With this understanding between us, let's set out on the path of applying mindfulness to intuitive eating. Chapter 1. Mindfulness is a form of self-care and respect. Whether you feel grateful for a full life or long to fill haunting gaps, there is likely a missing piece that you can't quite find. How to get your food in order and your body under control. That missing piece is so essential, it means you can't complete the rest of the puzzle. Your body might cause you great suffering. Perhaps you experience discrimination based on your body at work, in relationships, at the doctor's office. Shopping for clothing is painful and embarrassing. Going to the movies, sitting on a plane, riding a roller coaster. None of these spaces were made for you. So you focus on becoming smaller. Suffer now through diet after diet so that you experience comfort, inclusion, and visibility later. You just don't feel yourself at this weight. You know diets don't work, but wonder if you could just find the right one. You have tried to let go, but you simply cannot rest until your body is smaller, more toned, and less #RoxanneGay unruly. Unfortunately, you are not the first to think or feel any of these ways. Our sick culture places an inordinate amount of value on appearance, specifically thinness, youth, and beauty. It tells you in subtle and not so subtle ways that buying the products and services that move you toward these ideals will ultimately bring you the happiness and belonging you desire. You've been absorbing these messages since you were a child. They shaped the neural pathways your mind travels again and again, linking thinness with self-worth, fatness with danger, dieting with righteous effort, and restrained eating with discipline, health, and control. When you stick with a program, you feel worthy. When you can't, you feel like a failure. When your body does not comply with the culture's expectations, which you have internalized and come to think of as your own, you think the problem is you. This is how many people move through the world, though the specifics vary widely based on intersections of body size, race, class, age, ability, gender identity, sexual orientation, citizenship, geographic region, and whether you are neurodiverse. Your negative relationship with your body taints your relationship with your life, tinging everything with a not-quite-okayness that needs fixing. I used to feel this way. Never good enough. Never worthy of unconditional love. I was obsessed with self-improvement and ways to become better, different, ideally someone else. Dieting, though I rarely called it that, was one way I tried to change myself. Years later, I stopped drinking alcohol and saw how I used drinking, eating, and dieting to have a different experience than the one I found too painful to face. I finally saw how my intolerance for uncertainty and discomfort drove me to painful thoughts and actions that only deepened my suffering. I felt this poorly about myself while simultaneously benefiting from the privilege of being a thin, cis, able-bodied white woman. I do not know what it feels like to live in a fat body, a black or brown body, a disabled body, a trans body. These distinctions matter. Each marginalized identity you possess exponentially increases the bias that you suffer. You might internalize and weaponize these biases against yourself. The basic message is this: wanting to be other than you are is painful. But depending on their personal experience, people have varying and more complex reasons for wanting to be different. A year into recovery from alcoholism, I meditated for the first time. As I continue to practice and study Buddhist teachings, I learned that they have nothing to do with self-improvement. Meditation and the world of mindfulness that is derived from it is about being with yourself as you are. Mindfulness is a way of paying attention to yourself, your thoughts and feelings, your actions and reactions, that provides invaluable insights into what is really happening, what is working for you, and what is not. I have come to think of mindfulness as the most basic form of self-care, self-respect, and self-love. This is available to everyone. Ironically, the more I meditate and study, the more I both stay the same person I always was and simultaneously evolve and change. As Carl Rogers wrote in On Becoming a Person, the curious paradox is that when I accept myself just as I am, then I can change. The changes brought about through mindfulness may not be what you were hoping for. They are not the result of treating yourself as a problem to be fixed, but of learning to work with yourself as you are. This is a very different way of relating to yourself. It will take time to change the neural pathways that make you feel unworthy, that lead you to strive to be different. Yet it is possible with patience, attention, and practice. And it can continue throughout your life. Your changing brain. As mindfulness practices reached the West, scientists have studied their mechanisms and effects. Their research shows how paying attention in certain ways changes the structure and function of the brain and alters how you experience your life. Mindfulness practices like meditation increase gray matter in the parts of your brain that control decision-making, and decrease matter in the parts controlling the fight, flight, or freeze response. These changes alter how you experience unpleasant states. Pain, fear, stress, anxiety, and discomfort can be felt purely and not automatically interpreted as dangerous. When you sense less danger, you can become more curious about your feelings. If your habitual reaction is to self-medicate with food or disordered behaviors, you might instead find other ways to meet your actual needs. Mindfulness sharpens interoception, the ability to sense and accurately interpret what is happening in your body in real time. Hunger, fullness, and satisfaction can be felt in the body, as can fatigue, fear, loneliness, and all your other states and emotions. When you react in damaging, habitual ways less often, you can more skillfully respond to what your body is communicating. You understand what you need and feel empowered to practice self-care. You won't practice mindfulness because of increased gray matter, but you might because of how it makes you feel and how it affects your life. Mindfulness practices are associated with physical and mental health benefits. The stress hormone cortisol decreases. Depression, anxiety, obsessive-compulsive disorder, substance use, and chronic pain are mediated. Focus and concentration increase. Scientists have even begun to understand meditation's famous increase in compassion. How to pay attention. Jon Kabat-Zinn defined mindfulness as the awareness that arises from paying attention on purpose in the present moment and non-judgmentally. Most people understand mindfulness is about paying attention. What they miss is the importance of how to pay attention. If you have dieted a good portion of your life, you clearly know how to pay attention to nutrition labels, macros, calories, and every perceived microscopic change in your body. You have paid attention to thinspiration and fitspiration blogs and social media accounts. Paying attention is not a lacking skill for the dieter, but gentleness is. Gentleness is implicit in allowing things to just be, including yourself. Mindfulness helps you see things clearly, honestly, as they are. Before you can judge them as positive, negative, or neutral, things just are. Experiencing life in this pure, raw way can make it come alive. What was once straightforward, unexciting, and black and white suddenly becomes technicolor, richly textured, magnetizing. At least, that's how it's been for me. Food tastes brilliant. Flowers are tender and gorgeous. Your love for others is deep and otherworldly. Your suffering also comes into focus. Heartbreak aches dully in your chest. Anger stokes a fire in your belly. Shame feels like your entire body is caving in. But with the stability gained from mindfulness, you are more able to stay with these emotions. And the staying starts to feel important. Even your suffering is rich, part of what makes you alive. When life feels richer, you need less entertainment, less non-stop pleasure. You can be right where you are. Turning toward your in-the-moment experience is an act of true self-care. You might start to think of such moments as near-life experiences, in which you are fully present. Waking up to your actual life is the best use of your time, energy, and effort I can imagine, and both mindfulness and intuitive eating support you to do this. Paying attention with gentleness is the best way to practice body respect, which I define as continuing to treat your body with kindness and meet its most basic needs, even when you don't feel good about it or a part of it. You feed it, give it rest, and allow it to feel comfort and pleasure. It is unrealistic to expect yourself to love all parts of your body all the time. That basic self-care should be unconditional and not contingent on ever-changing and completely normal feelings about your body. How the Four Foundations of Mindfulness Support Intuitive Eating. This book is framed within the Four Foundations of Mindfulness: body, feelings, thoughts, and phenomena. But what do these have to do with food, self-care, and body respect? Mindfulness of body practices bring greater awareness to what your body is communicating, what it is feeling, and what it is asking for. Your body is innately intelligent. It knows what it needs. Mindfulness of feelings, built on the foundation of a body stabilized by unconditional caring, works with your emotions with gentleness. An intolerance for strong or negative emotions likely contributes to your confusion and suffering about your body. Seeing your emotions clearly makes it possible to identify and meet your true needs. Mindfulness of mind, or thought, guides you to remodel your brain by choosing to think thoughts that align with gentleness and self-compassion, instead of dieting thoughts that have driven you to hate yourself. You literally rewire your brain. Mindfulness of phenomena is about making connections between the different parts of your experience. For example, if you tend to approach food with rigid control, you probably apply that to other parts of your life, such as work, family, and relationships. Healing your relationship with food and body can filter into every other part of your life, and those of others. Irene's story. Irene struggled with body image, particularly after menopause. It took patience, consistent nourishment, and exploration of supportive resources like podcasts, research papers, she was into that, and books, before she could consider the change work that needed to be done was emotional and not physical. First, we met her biological needs, ensuring she was getting enough. With a body stabilized by proper physical care, she could delve into the emotional aspects of her relationship with food and body. For support, she started a body gratitude journal and discovered there was much she appreciated about her body and took for granted. Initially, this discovery provoked self-aggression and shame for having superficial thoughts. We processed this by normalizing how she had been conditioned by the culture to do so. Gradually, Irene softened into the messiness of her experience in a human body. A few weeks later, she caught a cold and felt a different level of self-awareness and self-care arising. By paying compassionate and mindful attention to her needs, she acknowledged her hunger and cravings for foods that were particularly soothing, such as oatmeal and chicken soup. She emerged from that illness, seeing the connection between tending to her physical body, her feelings, and her thoughts. Mindfulness and intuitive eating paved the way. Mindful moment, checking in with yourself. As you work with this book, ask the following questions and capture any noticings in your journal. When you feel hunger, think something specific, or feel garden variety discomfort, these questions will help you build trust and confidence in your body, mind, and heart. What emotions am I feeling right now? How comfortable do I feel working directly with these emotions? What sensations are present in my body in this moment? How confident am I in interpreting these sensations? What is the texture of my thoughts right now? What is it like to allow my mind to be as it is? How is my body, nervous system, trying to protect me right now? What in my environment might be affecting me? What do I need? How do I know? Mindful moment. Shamatha Vipassana meditation. Shamatha Vipassana, mindfulness awareness, is an open-eye breath awareness technique. Listen to these instructions and then use the guided meditation found at newharbinger.com/49401. Find a comfortable seat, either in a chair with feet flat on the floor or on a meditation cushion, couch, or bed with legs crossed loosely in front of you. Sit up straight while respecting the natural curves of your spine. Your sits bones, sitting bones, root down into whatever you are sitting on, while the crown of your head reaches gently up toward the ceiling. The back of your body is strong, while the front of your body is open and soft. Let your shoulder blades melt down your back and rest your hands, palms down, on the tops of your thighs. Think of your body as finding a balance of rest and effort. Take a moment to scan the front of your body, releasing any tension you don't need to maintain this uplifted posture. For example, in the ankles, hip flexors, belly, chest, neck, and face. Your mouth is closed, but not clamped shut. Your lips and teeth may be slightly parted. Your eyes are open, with a gentle gaze cast down and in front of you at a distance of 4 to 6 feet. The breath comes in and goes out through your nose without any specific technique. Just breathe naturally. Feel your body breathing. Locate for yourself where you feel the breath, whether at the tip of the nostrils, at the back of the throat, high up in the chest, or with the movements of the chest and/or belly. And place your mind's attention there. You are not counting breaths, following the breath, or observing the breath. You are feeling the breath. As you feel the breath, your mind will continue to make thoughts. Allow your mind to be as it is, whether stormy or dreamy or slippery. Take a moment to notice how you can simultaneously feel your breath and remain aware of sights, sounds, sensations, and thoughts. Feeling the breath can peacefully coexist with awareness. As long as you stay connected with a feeling of breath, even a little, no further action is required. Just sit and let yourself be. At some point, inevitably a line of thought will take you away from the breath completely, and you will become absorbed. You may be gone for mere moments or for minutes at a time until something recognizes you have forgotten you were meditating. When you realize you got lost, take an instant to acknowledge the thought. You can say silently to yourself, "Thinking." Then release it and gently guide your attention back to the feeling of the breath. Begin again. This is the practice. Still the body. Feel the breath. Let the mind be as it is. When you realize you have gotten lost, come back to the feeling of the breath. Take a fresh start. It is important to distinguish between the two types of thought. Thoughts that peacefully coexist with feeling the breath, and those that take you away from it. In feeling the breath and allowing the mind to be as it is.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.